Now let's do one thing. Okay, we will also try the yarn mode, okay? But before we go to the yarn mode, let's try to create an RDD, right? So one of the first things you need to learn is how to create an RDD, right? You can create the RDD in two ways actually. One is from a file. So I have a CSV file. I want to read it, create an RDD, you can do it. Second is, I don't have a file, but I have an array. You know Python, right? You have an array, or you have, what else you have, dictionary in Python. So I have a Python dictionary. I want to convert that into an RDD. That is also possible. Because sometimes your data will be in a data structure, not in a file, right? What if I have a dictionary of million objects and I want to read it as an RDD? I can create an RDD from a dictionary or any data type in Python. It can be a list or an array or any data type that you have. You can convert that into an RDD. And the first example that I'm going to show you for this is, all of you started, right? Okay, you can actually do this. Either you can copy paste or you can type it also. So you have a range function in Python. Do you know that? It will, if I say range 1, 100, what will happen? It will give me 100 numbers, right? It's a collection. Range 1, 100 means you get 100 numbers. Now these 100 numbers, I want to convert to an RDD, okay? So how do you do it is, you will call a function called parallelize. You can see here, I have written. Parallelize is a function which will convert any existing collection into an RDD. It cannot be used to create an RDD from a file. Like if you have a CSV file, I cannot say parallelize, it will not work. Only for Python collections like dictionaries or sets or array, anything that you have, you want them to convert, you can say parallelize. So right now I have a range of 100 numbers, or it is a collection of 100 numbers actually. And I'm saying that, hey Spark, parallelize this 100 numbers into an RDD called A. So A is your RDD now, actually, right? And I'm also saying SC dot. This is very, very important. So what is this SC, right? SC stands for Spark Context. You can see here. What is Spark Context? So this is a Python shell, right? What we started is a Python shell or PySpark shell. And if I write something here, any code I write, Python will execute it. That is wrong, right? I want Spark to execute it, correct? If I write a simple Python code here, Python will run it for me. I don't want Python to run it, I want Spark to run it. So in order to access the Spark libraries, you can use this object called SC. So when you say SC dot, you're saying that talk to Spark library and do whatever I'm saying. So I'm saying that talk to Spark and create an RDD from this set of numbers. Yeah, so there is something called Spark session object that you can use for data frames or Spark streaming. There, if you want to communicate with the library, you can use a Spark session object. SC is your Spark context object. In Spark 1.6, we don't have Spark session. We have SQL context, Spark context, and all. So remember, this object is required, this SC guy is required whenever you want to communicate with Spark. But now you create an RDD called A, right? And if I want to manipulate this RDD, I want to filter, or I don't want to call SC because already A is an RDD. And anything that I do on an RDD, only Spark can execute. Every time I don't have to say SC, but during the creation of the RDD, I have to say SC dot. And I say parallelize, that's the method. And I give the numbers, what is that, 1 to 100, 1, 100. So 100 numbers are now available as an RDD. But remember, Spark is lazy. Nothing is happening now. You typed your code, but it will not execute your code, because unless you call an action, Spark is not going to worry about what you are doing. And if you want to call an action, you can simply say a dot collect, and Spark runs, shows you the RDD. So simply collect is probably the most used action. Just try that. If you do a dot collect, you can see the. So now a Spark job ran. That's my whole point. a Spark job actually ran when you called the collect. It read the data into A, then it printed the data, and now you can see the data. We are okay with it. We are not doing any transformation right now. We are just looking at what is happening, right? Now, interesting question. How many partitions does this RDD has, right? Because I did not read it from Hadoop or anywhere. 1 to 100 is just numbers, right? So obviously, Spark should have partitioned the RDD. How many partitions? I don't know. Even you don't know. So if you want to see that, you can simply say a dot get. The method is slightly different. That's why I copied it here. Get num partitions. Get num partitions. We'll do a very interesting experiment. How many partitions you have? 8. I have 16. Fine. It may be different. Okay. Is there anybody who is having 16? How did you start Spark shell? Did you mention master local star? So that the number of partitions depends on the number of processor core. If you started with 3 cores, you get 3 partition. I did star when I started. I told you you can mention local star. So I think my machine is having 16 cores. So it has allocated 16 cores as of now. Yeah, you may be on a different machine. It's a cluster, right? So I am connected probably to a different machine. Maybe different machines actually. Now, behind the scene, these are all optimized. It does not mean like I'm getting a machine with full 16 cores or something. It will be multi-threaded, right? So I'm handling very small workload, right? So even though cores are allocated to me, if it is sitting idle, some other process may take it. So it is just saying that this RDD has, and I can prove it. If you want to try this, do this. Exit from here, okay? Exit, and says I want to start Spark shell with, let's keep a common number, what you want, 5, right? I will say what? 5. So I'm starting with what? 5 processor cores. And if I create the same RDD, I should get how many partitions? 5 partitions, ideally, right? Let's see what's happening. You can also try along with me. In the Scala Spark, up arrow actually works. Here it doesn't work. So I will say I want to create the RDD. Now, even if I exit and start, in the Scala shell, it will remember. At least the commands you typed. Python shell, I don't think it will remember. Now, if I do a get num partitions, how many I have? 5, right? Now, so that is what, when practically you do it, these are all confusing. You are in local mode. That means you are only on one machine. It's not a cluster. In that machine, I asked for local mode, I asked for 5 processor cores, and it has given me 5 cores. And now, if I do a get num partitions, I see 5. Because by default, how Spark is going to partition your data, it will assume that you have 5 cores, I'll create 5 partition, so each processor core can process 1 partition. Ideally, we are in local mode again. Now, this rule is applicable only if you do parallelize. If you read from a text file or something, it doesn't do like this. There is a different rule, okay? Now, another question, can I change this? Like, now it is creating an RDD with 5 partition, right? I want 10 partition, or I want 100 partition probably. Can I do it? Of course you can do it. Now, one thing is that you can repartition, but while creating the RDD itself, I want, let's say, 10 partition. So, you run this command, right? You can simply say comma 10. So while creating the RDD, you can mention the number of partitions. This is what we actually do in production. When we write the Spark code, be it you're reading from Hadoop or Mars or wherever you want, you will say read comma 10. That means I am explicitly asking for 10 partitions. Right. So it depends on the size of the data and all. Then you have to make a calculation how many partitions you want, but you can mention a number and those many partitions will be there in your RDD. No, it is not hard and fast rule. And again, that rule is applicable only in local mode. In yarn mode, you will say what number of cores, executor memory, driver memory, that way you manage. This is only for testing. This number has a value even in production. Even in production, when you're creating an RDD, you will say, okay, read from a CSV file. The CSV file size is 10 GB probably, okay? And comma 10, you say. So I want 10 partition. So now you have 10 partitions of RDD, and you could have asked for 10 executors. Each executor will take one partition, then it will process it. So that calculation you have to draw when you are reading it. But my point is, you can mention the number of partitions while creating the RDD. And you can also do repartitioning, right? So I can say a dot, what is the method? Repartition. And then I can say 11. Okay. And then if I do a dot get num partition, you can't change an RDD, right? So if you say a dot repartition, it will just return the parameter, it will not do anything because it cannot edit an existing RDD. So I have to say that repartition A and save it as an RDD called B. Now B will have the same data but 11 partitions. We will launch one more Spark shell, don't worry. But yes, so you can mention, now very interestingly, you can also say repartition 1 million. Possible, beautifully it will work. It will create 1 million partitions, but data will be available in 3-4 partitions, rest will be empty. And that's useless actually. So that number you mention, how many partitions you want, there is no control. Any number you can mention actually, right? It all depends on the resources you have, okay? And when you want to reduce the number of partition, C equal to B dot. Can you check the spelling of this thing? I always have a trouble with this. I think it is correct. C dot get num partitions. When you want to reduce the number of partitions, you say what? Coilies. So yesterday, there was a confusion on these two things. That's what I want to explain. So let's say this is your data. You have, these are partitions, okay? Three partitions are there. And I have data like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So I have 10 numbers in three partitions. And you can say what coil is. 2. If I say coil is 2, what will happen? It will reduce to 2 partition, right? What Spark will intelligently do, it will copy this 5 here and this 6 here and will delete this partition. This is coil is. Same setup if you are doing, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, then you have 5 and 6. 7, 8, 9, 10. Same setup, I can say repartition 2. This will also give me 2 partitions. But the difference is, it will do a full shuffle. This will go here, this will come here, this will go here, this will come here. It will shuffle the full data, then only reduce to 2. So this increases your network traffic. If you're dealing with terabytes of data, if I do a repartition to come down, that's not a good idea. Always do coilies. Coilies will intelligently minimize your data movement. But again, for increasing the number of partition, there is only repartition. There is no coilies for that. From 3, I want to go to 6, right? I have to always say repartition 6. There is no other way I can do. There is no coilies only for reducing. So coilies came later, I think. Initially, there was only a partition method called repartition. As an improvement came coilies, so that when you're reducing the partition, data shuffle is very less, actually. So always do coilies, don't do repartition for reducing.